Hello, and thank you for joining us for yet another installment of Public Works and Infrastructure. I am Lorraine Cochran Johnson. I serve as committee chair, where I sit alongside Commissioners Ted Terry and Commissioner Robert Patrick. Today, we will be following the agenda for June 21st as printed. And as such, we will begin with the minutes from our June 7th meeting. I would ask whether or not Commissioner Terry, you have had the opportunity to read those minutes. And if so, whether or not there is a motion from the floor.
Yes, Madam Chair, that those minutes are good from my perspective. So I will move to approve the meeting minutes from the previous PWI meeting.
Okay, and I will second that approval. All those in favor, show of hands and words. Aye.
Aye.
Okay, let the record reflect that we have found no fault and adopted the minutes from the meeting for June 7th. Today, we will have a water sewer capacity report update. So let's move into that at this time.
Thank you, Commissioner. Let me share my screen. Let's see. I'm seeing that. Oh, let's see. Great. Oops. Okay. I believe we are going to just briefly talk about the success we have had with our capacity assurance program. As you know, under the consent decree modification, we were presented with a different approach for the program. It allows us to utilize credits where we take credit literally for the work that we've done on the system. And we utilize those credits as we remove stormwater from the system and we free up more capacity. We are allowed to have developers, individual homeowners, business owners, get approval of their capacity requests. So we're happy to say, if you recall back a couple of years, we've had a huge backlog. We are really staying current, essentially. As of last week, there were 73 capacity requests that were in progress. So we really don't have that much of a backlog. Large developments, 17 of them make up greater than 180 days in the backlog. And that's because we now have a different opportunity for them where by utilizing the capacity policy, they could actually join with the county in partnership and generate credits by fixing our sewer system. So we do have some in the greater than 180 days, we're working with our large developers. We've had several meetings with them regarding this opportunity, and they will come before you as agreements for this committee to approve going forward. We do have four developments that are eligible if they wish to move ahead. We have capacities, capacity that is available for them. We just have not heard back from them or their documentation is not in order. So we're kind of waiting on them really for that. Generally, it takes about 2 to 3 months to go through the entire process. So everything from 90 days onwards, it's really just in the process. Even though we have some in the 90 to 180 days, a lot of these reflect waiting on correct information to come in and getting that feedback, because we do have some capacity credits available for the smaller developments. And of course, the large developments, we do have the opportunity to join with the county, sign the contract, and you're off and going. So that's really the summary. Now we have great success with that. And I think we really should be proud regarding that. And this is kind of a graphical representation of where we have come in March of this year, which is represented by this first line here. We essentially the green, the light green is actually all the development requests that we've approved with credits. The dark green is really they were certified using available capacity. So I believe Commissioner Terry, Madam Chair, had a question.
Yes, and before we, let me first say, because I remember in 2019, when I joined the Board of Commissioners and receiving the first water sewer capacity report, it is very hard to believe that we have made such tremendous gains. At that time, Ms. Hauser, there were 420 requests, and honestly, about 70% of them were 180 days or more. Mm-hmm. So this is what you truly call progress. And before I go to Commissioner Terry, as we look at this particular page, where you say 264 capacity request, I'm assuming that's the first line that we're seeing there. The 159 canceled. When we say canceled, does that mean that they were issued the ability to move forward? Or what does a canceled request look like?
So sometimes in our process, we actually get inquiries from developers. They may submit documentation, and sometimes financing goes through. Business deals don't happen, or they found another area of the county that they prefer, you know, sometimes with builders. We've spoken to a lot of them this year to really try to clean up our files and to ask a lot of builders and developers, are you truly going to build in this area or not? You know, you're in line. Otherwise, you know, we're going to hop over. And some of them have canceled their requests. So it's all feasible. You know, we have a pathway forward now for everyone. So cancellations are really not due to any waiting on our part now.
Understood. Thank you for that. And Commissioner Terry, go right ahead at this time.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And just it was on that last slide, or the second, just that one slide back.
Okay, previously.
Slide two. Yes. So the 73 capacity requests are in progress. So that's currently right now.
Right now.
And then because some of the, I guess, so for large developments, greater than 180 days, because it's just more complicated.
Yes.
Why is it?
So we have actually invited several large developers to go ahead. You know, we had the webinar letting them know that there is a pathway forward, aside from installing tanks at your facility, because that was the solution previously. To generate credits by joining with us as this board did previously for both Pepsi and Legacy, the affordable housing, approving the contracts whereby the county will fix the system, generating enough credits by keeping stormwater out of the system to allow the new development to happen. We have received contracts back. I think we've received three contracts back thus far. We're waiting on a couple of others. We're waiting on two of them. There's justification that they meet the criteria of affordable housing. So we're going through that process right now, and you're going to see them come before you at the next PWI meeting, hopefully. We're going to have a couple to approve. So that number is going to change from 17 in the backlog. It's going to get smaller. But a lot of times I think they also have to decide on the contribution, on the pricing, the cost, but it is a better option than we've had previously, whether it's the installation of tanks, which will require maintenance, et cetera.
Gotcha, thank you.
Okay, thank you. And seeing no other questions, Ms. Hauser, please feel free to move forward.
Okay, the other thing that I wanted to share, I believe, in a previous PWI committee meeting, a suggestion was made, and we had been working on this, so we really synced up, to have a tool that's available to the public to kind of let us know where we are. And as you can see from my screen, We've developed a sort of help guide to go through just a graphical representation of where capacity is, where the approvals are, as well as providing information. In addition to the website we have, we do have access that the public will be made available to the public regarding presentations, previous presentations regarding the banking system, questions a lot of developers may have. But what I want to really zoom in on right now is just a graphical representation. I think it was either Commissioner Patrick or Commissioner Cochran, Johnson, I can't remember which one of you asked about having information. I know Commissioner Terry, you were asking about understanding housing, but we wanted to see on a map where the approvals were. And this is what you're seeing here to the right-hand side of the screen. This is just everything. The items that are in yellow are still pending. So for example, you see where I've pulled that up, and that's a single family type project that's pending in that area. You could also see the ones that are in green have been approved. Mm-hmm. So this kind of highlights the work that we've done. We've had a great team moving forward, whether it was Della Taylor with Brent Zern, working with Yoler and Scott, or over here, we had our GIS team really come forward to help with this. So you could choose the year that you're looking at. You could choose, you know, we have selected right now, well, I've selected, for example, just single families. You could see if there are any schools that are available. There are less schools in the county, you know, a couple of them in there for 2022 that have been approved. So you could really see on a detailed basis that is available for you and for the public. We'll be rolling this out soon and tagging it to our sewer capacity page, just giving a graphical representation of the approvals and things that are still pending. We are still doing work where we would actually have a bit more information for individual developers or applicants where they could go through and they could actually see which part of the 6-stage process their application is in. And we plan to have that online and to really update it on a monthly or bi-monthly basis. So any questions?
Well, I always like empowering people. So I absolutely love the map. Now I see that it's located at DeKalbGIS.maps. Now, yes. This is not something at this point that has been transferred over to the DeKalb County website, Ms. Hauser?
It has not. We were waiting to share it with the board first before we rolled it out. And you had different toggles. So for instance, I just toggled on the commission districts and you could see the super districts as well, you know.
Understood. Now, one question that I have for you, Ms. Hauser, because I received the presentation and I filed that away, but was there a link to this included anywhere?
No, just because it's still on the GIS system, so you actually have to have a password to get into it. But then once our super GIS manager, Farah Pruitt, once she rolls it out, it will just be accessible where you will simply be able to click from our sewer capacity website, just click on the sewer capacity request and toggle through.
This is great. And, you know, we recently had a conversation because, of course, stormwater is a major issue. And, you know, what we are seeing here, I think, is a result of a combination of things, but both global warming and aging infrastructure all play a part. And of course, 60% of stormwater is controlled and owned by the county, but that other 40% belongs to the residents of DeKalb.
Yeah.
But it appears there's a general consensus amongst folks that when there is an issue with storm water, call DeKalb. So we've had the conversation on the creation of this same type tool that will inform individuals who's responsible for the storm water, because that's something that's a burden that's too great. Because in many instances, you're dealing with the consequences of builders who may have made poor decisions when they constructed communities, and or the solution that they chose at the time is no longer sufficient. As we see an increase in torrential rains and downpours. So I absolutely love the map. I can't wait to be more engaged with the map so that I fully understand it. I love the fact that you can click and it will tell you directly who has applied and or is seeking the sewer capacity. So again, I say congratulations, because I remember receiving a list with 420 people. And today to say that I believe we're down to around 73 or so is absolutely amazing.
Awesome, thank you.
Absolutely, great job.
Thank you. And so I think, Commissioner, that was a good segue into the other presentation.
Okay.
Just previewing the next presentation.
Yeah. So I will get that set up. Let me get that set up.
Absolutely. Well, so right ahead. You're moving.
We're doing some major education today. This next one's really informative. I learned a lot. So I've got lots of questions for you.
So I think, can you see it as a slideshow feature? Sometimes.
Yes, we can see it fine. Thank you.
Okay.
We see the whole thing though.
Okay. So really, as you just mentioned, Commissioner Cochran Johnson and Commissioner Terry, this is really informative on what we are doing as a government and what we probably need to let our community know about the sewer system. And the title of this is Managing Private Stormwater in the Public Sewer System. So just to lay the foundation, the public system only comprises of 60% of the entire sewer system. I know we got off to a slow start, but we have been committed to, and this committee has approved contracts, the consent decree modification, you know, the entire board has been extremely supportive in the work we have been doing. And thus far, we have spent together and we have invested over $600 million in the sewer system. We've lined 95 miles of pipe, completed almost 900 point repairs, upsized about 10 miles of sewer. I mean, this is ongoing rehabilitation, ongoing maintenance, you know, and we are continuing to do that work under the CIP and the consent decree, which will last until 2027. So that is clearly our job, which we are supposed to be doing. And we are expecting to remove 25 million gallons of stormwater or prevent that from entering the system, taking up capacity. One understanding as a bit of a background, we also need to discuss is the types of sewer system. There are combined systems, there are separated systems. The city of Atlanta has both, where you manage stormwater with the sewer or wastewater versus here in DeKalb County, our system should truly be a separate system where stormwater is managed in its own pipes and sewage or wastewater is managed in a separate system, and the two should not cross. However, as you could see from this discussion, stormwater is getting into the sewer system, and that should not happen. So let's look at the graphic. Again, we mentioned that the sewer system, and I'm not sure, should I wait on questions throughout or?
Well, you tell me.
I'm so sorry. I'm so busy.
I want to slow your flow, but you just made a very important point because you said the legacy systems.
Yes.
So does that mean that The government put in combined systems, or that private development was allowed to build private combined systems?
So I really think if you look at history, it may not have been a planned approach. It may have simply have been, we need to get rid of wastewater sewage. It goes straight to the river. I mean, that's essentially what the history was. There was not a sewage treatment plant, not throughout the metro area. It was just flow, allow the flow to go. And even in DeKalb County, we know certain waterways that received wastewater directly until those systems were forced to start connecting to a water treatment plant. So there's a lot of history there. So that's kind of the reason we say some of the legacy systems, but the ordinance does make clear that we are supposed to have a separate system. And we could talk about that. We're going to use an example at Agnes Scott later on, or we know there are connections directly from buildings that should not be connected to the sewer system. So yes.
Thank you.
So again, our sewers, and you could see that red line denotes what it's private and what it's public. And the private side is closer to the building. 60%, of course, as we mentioned before, it's our responsibility. 40% is the individual property owners. Mm-hmm. So we are fixing our public sewer pipes to reduce stormwater from entering it, but that is not enough. Private pipes add up to 50% of stormwater in our system. And we're going to get into a pilot study we did to determine that. So you can imagine 40% of the pipes are allowing 50% of the stormwater to get into the sewer system, taking up capacity. Mm-hmm. However, the whole point of this presentation is to let you know, and we will be coming back to the board regarding certain incentives that we want to roll out to help to manage this private stormwater. And this is just a graphic where you could see the public system, 2,400 miles, private, 1,600 miles total. So everything that's leaving your home, leaving your business, connecting to the public system, all of that presents avenues for stormwater rehab. So let's define the problem. I'm going to give you a couple of solutions we've implemented to date, and then what we're thinking our path forward should be to ensure that we're not just reducing the capacity that gets clogged up with additional stormwater, but that's what causes spills. You have additional stormwater that's coming into the system. Madam Chair, I think Commissioner Terry.
Yeah,
absolutely. And just, you know, let's use our raised hand feature. Go right ahead, Commissioner Terry.
Yeah, I think you just made a good point there, because so private pipes add up to 50% stormwater to the sewer systems. And so you're showing a residential neighborhood here, and I know you're going to show Agnes Scott later. So is it mostly the residential laterals that are that 50%, or are there like commercial and I guess university, like how does it break down in terms of that?
So I don't have an answer for that, but we could get it to really analyze what we think from an anecdotal perspective. We do know on GIS where certain private laterals are, but we don't know all of them. Okay. We do know where they connect. We kind of would have to approximate that, but I'll see if our GIS team could help us figure out that.
Okay. And I guess, is it, so in the residential areas, are we finding that a developer built a subdivision and created a stormwater pipe connected into, I assume they did their own sewer. Actually, that's a good question. Did they, once the developer, anyway, so, because one of the graphics that you're going to show, sorry to jump ahead, but it actually has a pipe from the stormwater to the sewer system. Who actually did that?
Right.
The builders.
So in the past, that's exactly right.
You're like, what?
In the past, and if you think about it, a lot of communities have been here for decades.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's so much easier to just run one set of pipes and just connect everything up and keep it going.
Okay. All right. So
the long term.
Okay.
Right. So we have some legacy issues. So probably I know y'all know this information, but to give anyone who may be watching a background, when we started the consent decree, we initially thought that the cause of of SSOs were blockages, fats, oil and grease, fog, or debris. CEO Thurman, when he came in, he wanted additional assessments and analysis done to really find out root causes because we were still having spills going on. It wasn't until really 2019, we really zeroed in on inflow and infiltration. And that's another way of saying stormwater entering into the system, whether on purpose or just by deteriorating lines. So this is kind of the timeline going through to get us to where we are, utilizing the hydraulic model to identify and optimize various strategies for stormwater reduction. So this is the more technical term when we say infiltration and inflow, but it's simply just a pathway for groundwater and stormwater runoff to enter into the sanitary sewer system. It could enter through the public system where we may have manhole lids that are perforated or cracks in the system based on just age or even roots of trees getting in. And likewise in the private system where you may have, in this graphic, you actually see roof drains that are connected or foundation drains that are connected to the system, as well as faulty manholes on private development or your clean out cap. This is something that's really easy. You could go to your home or any business and you could see cleanout caps that are not on. And that's like 6 inches that allows rain or stormwater to get in. So this is an example. Typically on a sunny day, you have dry weather flow. You may have some groundwater depending on your groundwater table, but here comes some clouds and rain. And what happens? Stormwater system, it fills up. And that is how we have spills. The system gets to fill during rainy events and it comes out somewhere, the lowest point in the system for that area. So some of the defects that which may impact our sewer lines that we're seeing on the public side, and we could imagine that likewise private owners would have these happening on the private side. So the average span of the older clay pipes and the concrete sewer pipes is around 50 to 60 years. We have pipes that have been out there from the 40s, when we were having the boom in after World War II and development and growth, that's still out there and they tend to fail, they tend to break. And you can see from the pictures there, you also have roots. This hairy piece in there, that's just roots growing into the sewer system. So one example of a direct inflow, so remember the technical term is infiltration and inflow, it's the Agnes Scott College. That was constructed back in 1951. And utilizing smoke testing, this is where you just send smoke into the sewer system and just see what happens. And when you see smoke coming out of drains, as you have over here, the vented drains, or even in the ground, something is wrong. That should not be happening because that they should not be connected to the sewer system. When we discovered that in 2017, it was coming from the Campbell Hall storm drains and roof drains. And that we actually engaged on getting the college to disconnect. They really obliged. And that saved and provided additional capacity to the sewer system because stormwater should just run off and go directly back into the waterways. Thus far, our team, our contractors led by DWM, David is on here. We have performed smoke testing on 1,770 miles of sewer pipe, 68% of the county. And we have identified over 8,000 defects, cross connections on private portions, broken caps, uncapped healing outs, a vast majority of things. I think Commissioner Terry had another question.
I see that he does. And I have a question for you on the smoke test that you just indicated. As we are finding these issues, are the bulk of these issues that we're detecting private issues, or are these primarily public? I figured you would say private.
And when we do smoke testing, we are looking at private issues. We are looking because we feel the typically when we're looking at the public system, we do utilize smoke testing on the public side, but we utilize acoustics, we utilize CCTV, we utilize other, you know, we may drop a simple pole cam in there, dye testing as well. But the smoke testing, that's why we go through the neighborhood and we have to put hangers and everything, because people are going to see smoke coming out from their roofs, or, you know, and they may think, you know, the home is on fire or something. Well, no, it's really, you're connected to the sewer and you should not be, type deal.
Understood. And are we giving these individuals some form of notice? And is there a period of time for a right to cure?
Yes. So we will talk about that later on, because it's a tiered approach because costs come in. And we are proposing how we plan to deal with that going forward. So it's a myriad of solutions we're going to have to take. And I'll get into that later. But yes, we are notifying them. We are giving them, it depends, I should say. And I'll like to discuss that in a little bit more detail to come.
Understood. And Commissioner Terry, go right ahead at this time.
Thank you. And so in this, an earlier slide, you list 25. The goal is to remove 25 MGD. Is that millions of gallons?
Millions of gallons.
Okay. What does the D stand for?
Per day.
Per day. Oh my God.
Yes. Millions of.
Okay. I thought MGD. Maybe that was, I thought that was a high number, but you said per day, and that's, so it really is a high number.
Yes.
Okay, so in regard to the these 8,500 defects that have been identified already, what percentage of that 25 million gallons per day is coming from like these private, sort of these sort of defects? And then what percentage of the 25 million is coming from the what I thought was the main culprit, the roots? The root intrusion.
So the 25 million, that's just us. That's the public side.
Oh.
That's not the private side.
But these are coming into the public, right? So these
eight. It is, but what we have calculated, what our team has calculated, what we project to fix on the public side, we are calculating, let's say a pipe was riddled with roots, allowing cracks. When we fix the public side, we're going to get rid of a source of stormwater infiltration.
Right.
That 25 million, it's part of that. It's not what could happen on the private side. And you're going to see in the future slide what we are getting concerned about. As we fix the public system, we think things are going to keep on getting worse on the private system, and start even creating additional stormwater as we on the public, and I have a graphic on it, start moving out, it starts getting filled in a little bit by the private side. So that's why we're kind of having a call to arms to try to come together, and the CEO, you know, our team, the administration is laying out some solutions to the issue, but it is, we are starting to raise the alarm on it. So the 25 million, that's us. That's just roots in our area, cracks in our area in the public side. Nothing on the private.
I gotcha. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
So how did we come up with the idea that 50% of the stormwater is coming from the private side? What we did, this is a schematic of an area in the county where we performed a pilot study. And we rehabilitated everything on the public side. We dropped flow monitors to understand the significant inflow and infiltration or stormwater getting into the sewer system. We analyzed that first, determined that we will utilize this as a pilot, and we rehabilitated everything on the public side. That included 19,000 linear feet of pipe, 95 manholes, and even 210 lateral collection. We spent $2.6 million doing it. And we only got the benefit of reducing 50% of the stormwater after spending $2.6 million and fixing everything on the public side. And that's how we came up with, wow, 50% in that area. And we're kind of extrapolating it. We know that some areas of the county may be more, some may be less, but we utilize this to kind of give us a peg, a starting point for what we believe it's really happening on the public, on the private side.
And so again, Maria, do you know that? Do you know that because you go back and measure it after rain events?
Exactly. That's exactly what we did. So we compared, you see on the slide, we're saying here, we compared the flow meter data from before and after. And, you know, again, this is what, you know, was happening. And we removed only this amount. You know, after all that work, all those, that money, that investment we put in there. And this is why we want to kind of elevate this issue, because 50%, that's huge from 40% of the pipes. So,
yeah.
And additional smoke testing, you note here in this area, we think 20% of the properties have potential stormwater sources as well. In this area. So it's something we do need to address. So here are some of the solutions that we've implemented today. I know it seems like a huge issue. We are addressing, you know, SSOs from blockages in a couple of ways. You know, we are, you know, utilizing our, what we call, we actually root in there. David, can you give me, I'm blanking out on what we do in clear, we rod, I'm sorry. So this is an example of a rotting truck where we take care of blockages in, which could be preventing capacity as well. So we really do a good job of removing, you know, over 3,000 tons of debris, clearing easements of roots and everything, treating sewer pipes for root control so that we don't have blockages, don't have cracks forming on the public side. We're maintaining that and we send out flyers, we enforce with restaurants, et cetera. We continue on the public side again to do the rehabilitation, replacing vented manhole lids with solid lids to reduce that inflow. So that's all work that we're doing on the public side. So during a storm, we see millions of gallons of stormwater entering the system. And as we noted again, Commissioner Terry, our aim is to remove 25 million gallons from the system by 2027.
A day.
Right, per day. But as you could see, let me go back to that representation. What we are concerned about is that even as we reduce that amount, and every system, it doesn't matter how well you maintain a system, every system is going to have a level of stormwater. It's just a fact. You know, you may put in a pipe today and, you know, in a week or something, a piece of stone may have gotten in there and clanged it, dinged it. There is going to be stormwater. But our biggest concern is as we reduce, the private side is going to go up. So that's the challenge that we face with dealing with this. And not all of the public assets are scheduled to be rehabilitated by 2027 either. That's going to be an ongoing basis. Now, one thing that I want us to consider as we have that million gallon perspective, that the spill volume for Meadow Creek Path, you know, that's a representation right there in the picture. The highest volume SSO, we experienced 13.2 million gallons in 2021 when you add it all up. So we expect a really different DeKalb when we remove that 25 MGD. We're expecting great things, but the concern is that removal going to be eroded by what's happening on the private side?
Mm-hmm.
So let's think about, let's talk about what we're doing to kind of address the private side. We focused on a couple of areas. We've broken them out. Either you have broken or missing cleanout caps, you may have deteriorated sewer lines, or you may have a connection which should not be connected. So like your roof drains, your area drains, your sidewalk drains. And the reason we break it out into those three categories, there's a cost associated with it. You could probably go to Home Depot, Lowe's, other hardware stores, Ace, whoever, and get a clean out cap for under $20. And you may be able to put that cap on yourself. That's a huge difference from if you have a deteriorated sewer lateral that may cost you anywhere from $3,000 to $5,000. And depending on how deep they are, they could reach up to $25,000 to repair a sewer lateral that's deteriorating. The connections of the roof and area and sidewalk drains, that may require you to actually install stormwater piping to the stormwater system. And that's an additional cost to lay new pipe, similar to putting in the private repair laterals. So I'll pause there to see if there are any questions regarding that, because that's a huge price distinction mm-hmm. for a lot of homeowners, business owners, et cetera. Oh, Commissioner Sherry?
Yes, and on that point, so I guess it's possible that on a single family home that was built 80 years ago, they might have a gutter downspout going into, it's looked like one of those graphics was like going into a some sort of drain, I guess, that eventually
right.
also dumps into the sewer lateral from the house. But then there was another graphic where it almost seemed like an entire street stormwater pipe was just had its own like street connection into a sewer yes. lateral. So can you talk about the distinction between a private individual home and then maybe an entire development that might have that situation?
So I think it really depends on an entire development could still be private if the county has not accepted that system. Right now, so there's a difference. You have an individual homeowner. Clearly, that is a private system. However, sometimes an entire development may be public or it may be private, depending on whether the county has accepted that infrastructure. And we do have processes in place for accepting infrastructure. However, we require that infrastructure is brought up to current codes before the county accepts it now. At times, if a developer builds something, we're requiring bonds, whether it's a performance bond or a maintenance bond, to be held for a year to ensure that the system is working properly before we accept it. And we have our inspectors who go out and look at those things. We actually David could chime in as well, but we do have an enforcement arm of DWM, which are sworn officers, and they could go out and write things up. They do it for fog, they do this for connections, et cetera. That is an option there, but it's a difference, but it's still private versus public. However, it's tied in depending on ownership. I hope that answers it, Commissioner Terry.
Yeah, it does.
Okay.
Are there any other questions? Let's go down the chain here, and I see none.
Okay. So because of the wide, vast in cost, to individual homeowners and business owners regarding sewer laterals. And I mean, this could be applicable to your water system as well, your water private laterals. But to address some of the concerns, we have instituted and we've had in place a clean out cap replacement program where if we've discovered that your clean out cap is the issue, you will get a letter which is listed on the right-hand side. It gives you a time frame to rehabilitate it. And you send back in pictures to us and you are released under that program. It's pretty simple. Doesn't cost a lot of money. You could have a plumber address it. You could address it yourself if you think you could screw something back on after you purchase it from Home Depot, et cetera. That's one aspect. The DeKalb Cares program, thanks to the board for approving $2.5 million to help with sewer laterals. That is out there for low-income families. And Zach could talk a little bit over as to when it will roll out. I think we were signing the contracts recently this week, Zach, or next week. So that program will be there and available up to $2.5 million for low-income families. And what we've done, we've actually been proactive. We've looked at all of the smoke testing data. Jacobs did, Kai, maybe watching, or Brad Cleckley. We've listed out all the properties which we believe in DeKalb County may have some lateral issues. So we kind of know, and this program will be available for low-income families. Under the credit policy, which we talked about at first, when the county provides credits to a developer or somebody that's applying for sewer capacity, we ask them to comply with the ordinance, which says you need to have a sealed system, no cracks, no inflow from roof drains, et cetera. So before we give property owners the credits and say, yes, continue to build, you could rebuild this older home, you're tearing it down, developer, you're rebuilding on it. Okay, you have to assure us with a plumbing certification that your sewer laterals, it's in proper shape, no roots are in there, it's sound, and your roof drains, floor drains are not connected to the sewer system. So those are three ways we are requiring our community members, the private homeowners, to kind of engage in this process to reduce stormwater for getting into the system. Now we have proposals. And I think there are a couple of hands up, so I'll pause there for a little bit.
Absolutely. This, go ahead, Commissioner. Well, I'm not sure here which came first, but Commissioner, Commissioner Larry Johnson, go right ahead.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Great presentation, Professor Hauser. Appreciate this. Just a question about the county financing repairs, Mr. Williams, because I'm still waiting on us on how we're going to help our seniors over in the Ellenwood area to get off the septic that could probably help this this runoff. And so it's been almost a year or two. Where are we in the process of getting that rolled out?
So a couple of the programs, matter of fact, while Director Hauser was talking, I had a conversation where we're finalizing one of the programs that is what we call the Care and Conserve. The board has allocated approximately $5 million yes. to that. So I anticipate final signature on that document in the next 7 days. And that will allow for assistance in getting people connected.
Do you have application ready?
Well, yeah, the company has all of that, Commissioner. That's what we did is we bought a service, if you will.
Okay. And the company name is what again?
Project Nehemiah. They're doing this for the city of Atlanta as we speak.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Please send me information on Nehemiah.
Sure. Hopefully yeah. The next time we have a conversation, it will be in the context of a press release and all that stuff.
So I thought that Nehemiah was just doing for water bills, so help assist with utilities.
No, so the water bills, Commissioner, is the Urban League and the Partnership for Community Action. The board also allocated funds for those, and so that's also moving. That's another approximately $5 million.
Great. Okay. Just send me the information so I can, and you will roll it out. Do you need our approval for that? Or you
You've already approved it. Already approved. Just, mm-hmm. yeah, these both, all of these, I believe, went through PWI to the board. So they're all moving, sir.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
And next, I assume that answered Commissioner Johnson's question. So now I'll come to you, Commissioner Terry.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think this is the most interesting slide of them all. Because it's like, what are we going to do about it? In regards to, I think you were getting ready to talk about it, about the financing.
Yes.
So can you just speak to that real quick, and then I want to ask my question.
Okay, so there are a couple of other efforts. Of course, we want to educate, but we are rolling out what we've looked at in other jurisdictions is they have said, okay, at the point of sale or refinancing, that's an opportunity where we could require not just doing a home inspection, which everyone does, but let's look at an inspection of your laterals, whether it's water or sewer lateral, and assess it. And that's fixing that has to be part of the deal because the ordinance requires that the system be airtight. So that's one thing we're looking at. And then we're looking at possibly financing repairs. And that's along the lines of right now we have an opportunity on the water billing side where we have installment plans where you pay your current bill, but you also have an installment plan for your, you know, what you have in arrears. Looking at that going forward, we're still investigating. Of course, we're going to need a legal team to glance in. We also looked at possibility of insurance. I think there were two other metro cities or counties which have looked at that as well. I know it's not up here on the bullet point, but we've tossed that around, but we still need to do a couple of investigations. So I hope that lays the foundation for your question.
Yeah, no, I think that's, those are all really, I think I agree with all those tracks. I feel like we should pursue all of the above. When it comes to the financing, and I'm thinking mainly like a homeowner that whether they qualify for the low income assistance or maybe sort of, you know, because there's going to be a lot of people who probably don't qualify for the assistance, but also, you know, $25,000 or even $3,000 would be like, I know in the energy sector, there is a concept called pay as you save and they don't do this in Georgia because, you know, other reasons not related to us, but in other states, a homeowner can, in essence, finance an energy efficiency improvement on their home, and they just pay for it sort of on their power bill. Okay. And the concept is that it doesn't matter who lives in the home, that it's a utility, and that power bill and that power meter, you know, regardless of who lives in it now or 10 years from now, the improvement of the energy efficiency, investments is good for the whole system. And so therefore it just stays with, you know, the meter, so to speak. So it doesn't matter who actually the person is that owns the home or is the customer. And so I wonder if that same accord, if there's something, you know, in essence, like it doesn't matter who lives at that house, you know, the financing of these lateral repairs, because they're important for the overall system health, that it would just basically be attached to the meter. So in other words, that meter, for however many years it takes to pay off that improvement, is set, you know, regardless of who lives there or not. So I want to bring up that one point. I'm also wondering if our stormwater fee assessment might come into play here, because I just wonder how we interpret, you know, so how do we gauge a, the stormwater fee for a residential property and its impact on the stormwater system. But how does that equation change if now the stormwater is actually going
to the stormwater,
going into the wrong pipe, right? And so I don't know if it's, I mean, it seems like
We'll have 25 million more gallons in the stormwater system now. We will.
Well, yes. Well, I'm thinking about it both ways. I'm thinking about it. Yeah. Can a stormwater fee be, in essence, sort of have a different formula where if there are serious lateral issues, that fee should somehow come into play for fixing some of these issues. So I don't know. It doesn't, I mean, I know it's not very much, you know, it's like $44. Right. So I know it's just a small, very small measure. And then I guess maybe the kind of the big question is, because looking at all of the, you know, thousands of potential privately owned parcels and knowing we can't fund all of them through the grant programs and, you know, affordability might be an issue for some. Is the policy for us to sort of, you know, expedite these repairs as quick as possible? Or is it more about, you know, what we can afford? So in other words, does it make sense for us to increase the credit system? Like, are we maybe the system is paying more to make those repairs because it means that those repairs will happen quicker and therefore the whole system will benefit. Does that make sense?
Let me try to repeat that. We have the credit system, which is generated from the county fixing the public system.
I'm sorry, and I mean like the plumbing. So like when isn't there like a credit on a bill that if someone gets the repair done, it's like a few hundred dollars?
Oh, so you're talking about the low flow devices getting a rebate.
No, not the low flow. I think it's,
yeah, so I think, if I may, Marie, I think he's sure. Speaking of that, but as well as if you have a leak you pay the bill, right? So you $100.
Okay. Once
you fix the leak, we will adjust your bill. And I think, is that what you're speaking to, Commissioner Terry?
Yeah, I'm trying to remember because we don't pay for the whole repair. We just kind of give a small.
No. Actually, we will adjust your bill.
Oh, adjust the bill. Okay, gotcha.
We'll adjust your bill to recognize that the leak is, you know, an isolated incident. Upon proof that you.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. That makes sense. Okay. All right. So maybe the biggest question I have is because I did attend a presentation of the water planning district. What's it called? The metro.
Yeah, the North Georgia. Yeah.
Yeah, the North Georgia, and they had kind of reminded me of something I'd forgotten about it. But so we have and you referenced it earlier with the fog, you know, thinking it was the fog that was the problem, but that was a dry cycle.
Right. Exactly.
So what do the climatologists tell us about, you know, because I feel like we've been in the wet cycle for Atlanta, but are we going to be in a dry cycle, you know, for the next 6 years, you know, like how does that come into play as we're doing these plans?
Well, we have, I'm not sure how much we've looked at that when we were doing master planning, but if you recall, we've done master planning up to 2050, and in some cases, even up to 2070. As to what we expect for growth. And that's our biggest driver. I know climate and whether we're in a wet cycle or a dry cycle, that will impact the amount of spills we may have in the system. But I think still to address growth becomes a challenge as to building out the system and making sure as we go through these cycles, because the cycle is going to come back around, whether in a decade or two, we're going to be back in the same situation. And you can imagine the clay pipes from the 40s and 50s would not have gotten better in a decade or so. So I think in the dry season, it may be advantageous. So wherever we are to start working towards a solution gradually.
Okay. So. And is the metropolitan or the North Georgia,
yeah.
North Georgia, you know, plain district.
Yeah, so, we know.
What are they? Do they have any projections on the wet cycle, dry cycle? Do we know anything?
I'll try to find out. I know Lee is on and AECOM did the master planning. I'm not sure how much they focused in on what we will see as far as the climate or even climate change. I think we have had discussions where we actually think the weather is going to become more extreme with climate change, whether you have a greater dry period of drought and then a horrendous wet period. So it's that alternative is out there, but I'll make a note of that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and I see at this time, Commissioner Rader.
Thank you, Commissioner Cochran-Johnson. Interesting discussion, and I'm particularly interested in the follow-up dialogue. You know, we talked about the action that we had taken in order to defray the cost of high water bills on folks with limited income. Now we're talking about how to help people fix their system, and then the credits that we give folks for lost water associated with a break in their line. But we also approved a policy by which that casual irrigation use would not be counted against the sewer bill. And I'm starting to get calls. It's a warm, you know, we're starting to see people watering their petunias because it's hot and dry. And so how can I direct ratepayers to apply for a credit for casual irrigation?
Mr. Rader, unless you have it, Director Hauser, because we've had conversation, and that was a result of, I think, the fee increase. We did commit to bringing something back in the summer. Let me get an update on where that is and provide it at the next meeting.
Okay, because I'm starting to get, you know, I mean, people are saying, hey, my bill jumped up. And I said, did you look at your sewer bill? And they say, oh, yeah, boy, that sewer bill is high, but I was irrigating my water. I didn't put the water in the sewer. So, you know, that's the dynamic we're trying to address. And I think it's going to, we need it, you know, now when we're seeing people do more of that casual irrigation. The second question that I have is, you know, we are behind schedule on issuing new watershed debt. What do we need to do at watershed in order to make us ready to do that? I know that supposedly we need to hire a financial advisor in order to begin this process, but what needs to be done in watershed for us to be ready to issue that new public debt?
So, Commissioner Rader, beyond the getting the financial advisor, I don't know if there's any specific activities that need to take place.
Have we begun disconnecting?
I was going to say, of course, there is the discussion where we need to be in that process, and I'm not certain whether that would be a dependency or not. But we anticipate, you know, this is based on the timeline of the new debt issuance in the late summer, early fall. And I cannot imagine that by the time we get there, that we're not disconnecting in those instances where it's necessary to disconnect.
Okay. How far have we run through the $70 million that we borrowed against tax funds?
I want to say there's about $40 million left, rough numbers. Email I think I saw last week.
$40 million, do you expect to spend that?
40, is that what you said?
40 is left. And do we expect to spend that by the end of the year?
Yeah. Do you have that, Maria?
We do anticipate spending that by the end of the year. The good news is we continue to get revenues in month to month, but of course those revenues aren't sufficient to cover all of the capital costs, which is why we do need both a new bond issuance and the refunding, if it's still feasible to go forward.
I'm all for both.
Yeah.
Thank you. All right, those are my questions. And so I'll look forward then to you reporting back hopefully soon on the credit program for casual irrigation. Yep.
Yes. Absolutely.
All right, thank you.
Okay, thank you. And without delay, Ms. Hauser, thank you so much for the insightful presentations and the work that's been done here. At this point, I would ask that we now progressively and quickly move into the adjudication of our agenda items. So I'm going to continue down the list. And the first item that we have in queue is item number 1624, and this is a change order. It's change order number 6 for annual water and sewer construction for use by the Department of Watershed Management, primarily for providing installation and repair of water and sewer pipes in various sizes. This request seeks to increase the contract funding and term through June 30th of 2023. On this particular item, awarded to GS Construction, Inc., SDNC Inc., and the Renee Group / CAMKIN Consulting, RGI, CAMKIN JV. This particular item has gone through audit on 16/24. And at this time, before making any further comments on this item, because we did not have discussion last time because it was pending audit, I will go to you, Mr. Hayes.
Good afternoon, Commissioner.
This has come out of audit. I didn't have that.
I've not seen it come out of audit either.
Hold on just a moment.
My understanding was still in audit.
Commissioner Cochran, Madam Chair. This is still an audit, and LaVoy Campbell actually thinks they'll have it ready by next PWI.
Yes, I see he has a target completion date there of July 5th on this particular item. So do forgive me. At this time, I would ask that we defer the item. There's some more commentary that I'd like to have concerning the item, but we'll have it all at the appropriate time. As of course, there has been issues raised concerning CAMKIN, and I would like our legal department to speak as it relates to our position. So at this time, if we can defer 1824 pending the completion of audit, that would be the ask at this time.
Yes, Madam Chair, I'll motion to defer this item for I guess 2 weeks, right? Is that the next?
2 weeks, absolutely. Yeah. Right. Next meeting. And I will second that motion. All those in favor, show of hands and words. Aye. Okay. We have deferred item number 1624. Next, I have item 1341. Please allow me to go to my notes before I speak on 1341 to verify where we are with this item. This item is also in progress. It has not come out of audit. So I would ask at this time, Commissioner Terry, that we also defer it until it completes audit, as that is the standing rule of PWI.
Yes, motion to defer this item pending audit, this item 1341.
Okay, we'll defer for 2 weeks. I will second. All in favor, show of hands and words. Aye. Let the record reflect, we have also deferred item 1341. Next item that I'm showing is item number 1464. And this particular item is time sensitive. I show that the audit is complete and we approve it pending audit. Yes. So this particular item was approved pending audit. And it does appear, hold on one moment, let me go back to notes. It was supported. So what I will say, because we approved it last time pending audit, the audit is now complete. So I would ask that we, because we have already given this item discussion, of course, I will read, strike the item so that everyone is familiar with it. It is a low bid for ferric chloride, liquid oxygen, and various chemicals for use by the Department of Watershed Management for providing chemicals to treat drinking water for DeKalb County residents. I would ask that now that we do have a proper supported item from audit, that we go ahead and approve it, move towards an approval for the full BOC.
Motion to recommend approval for item 1464.
And I will second. All those in favor, show of hands and words.
Aye.
So we have approved the item. It was heard in last committee, and it was supported in audit. The next item that I'm showing is item number 1593. And on item 1593, I'm showing that it remains in audit. Let me go to my secondary file, and it remains in progress as well. With this particular item, being 29 million, I would ask that we defer. This is a low bid for on-call mechanical, electrical, instrumentation and controls, maintenance services for Scott Candler, Pole Bridge, and Snap Finger wastewater treatment plants for use by the Department of Watershed Management for providing mechanical, instrumentation and controls, maintenance services to the county. May I have a motion, Commissioner Terry, if we are in agreement here on the deferral?
Yes, that sounds great. I'll motion to defer for 2 weeks, item number 1593.
Absolutely, and I will second as well. All those in favor, show of hands and words. Aye. We have also deferred 1593 pending audit. The next item that we have here, we're now down to our new agenda items, is item number 1697. And this is for aesthetic improvements for Glenwood Road, Covington Highway, and Red Wing Circle bridges over I-285. Now going to my personal notes on 1697. This is for $525,000 that will come from SPLOS for upgrading elements of the bridge, better known as the parafence, coming from transport and SPLOS funds for upgrades along these areas. Of course, these are technically GDOT bridges, but if we desire improvements, we have the responsibility for making them. So as a part of our desired aesthetics and improvements along those bridges, we have $525,000 that is the ask. Who is available to discuss this particular item?
I can certainly address it, but I believe you summarized it very succinctly, and that certainly is the request to make these a little bit more aesthetically pleasing, and we certainly would request that approval of this item.
Understood. Commissioner Terry, you have any questions concerning making these bridges more aesthetically pleasing?
Well, I think, everyone has their own opinion about aesthetics and what looks good and what doesn't. So basically, the Memorial Drive 285, overpass, there's just a more decorative fence. And so literally, we're just going to do exactly the same thing.
Yeah, pretty much the same thing. Yeah. There may be minor variations, but pretty much the same thing.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I think the fencing is fine. I was going to say that we should like take it like a little bit further and, put DeKalb County on it or something. It's just, I don't know. I'm a big believer in the gateway improvements and planting flowers and nice architectural and artistic features. But I understand maybe the budget just is going to pay for the fencing. But I do think we should look at, branding, sort of our entry and exits on especially the interstates, because we do have more, I was told we have more interstate miles in DeKalb County than any other county. So it's a great opportunity, I think. I know the CIDs really sort of specialize in it because I think, they raised the money specifically for that. So I don't know. I hate to I'll support it because obviously y'all decided to spend this before I got here. But I would just say in future beautification, gateway enhancements, we should really, look at doing the whole shebang. We should plant flowers, landscaping, little architectural features, put, DeKalb County across it. So that's just my own comments, but I'm happy to move to approve this item.
Okay. I do understand, Commissioner Terry, your sentiments and thoughts. I do believe that before the item comes, there would need to be a comprehensive layout and design, if that is the avenue that we're going to undertake. And also, as it relates to economic development, I know that in Snellville and certain other areas, you see extremely decorative designs, but they are in line with the aesthetics and the planned development of that particular area because it lends to the character of that area. So not opposed to what has been stated at all. I do believe that in order for us to act upon the expressed desires, it would just honestly take a different plan. And at this point, what we have is just for the general upgrades. Mr. Kingsbury, I do see your hand. Go right ahead.
Good afternoon, folks. Just real quickly, this was a budget line item of $1 million included in the original SPLOSH referendum. It didn't at that time have particular projects identified. When Georgia DOT advanced the replacement of three bridges across I-285 as part of the future major investment program, the county asked if they could have a fencing design similar to what's on Memorial Drive, which is a decorative aluminum fence that GDOT has installed on most new bridges, if the county governments would pay the extra difference. And we, at that time, the board approved $350,000, I forget the exact number, to have the decorative aluminum fencing. Then they came back, now the projects are under construction, the contractor asked, would the county also like the upgraded decorative parapet wall, which is cast in place with some relief panels to make it more decorative than just a slab of concrete for the Jersey barrier walls between the travel lane and next to the sidewalk. And the cost there is, again, what the line item is here today. So it's probably not what everybody envisioned at the time the referendum was put together 4 years ago, but it responds to a need that came about because of the major projects on 285.
Understood. And at this point, the ask for the more decorative parafencing that is in line with Memorial is $525,000. And I believe that it's in order. I agree with Commissioner Terry. And do you have a question, Commissioner?
Yeah, there was, Mr. Kingsbury mentioned, I guess this is a line item in the SPLOST. So what's remaining in, I guess, the beautification gateway line item? And do we have plans for those?
I believe it'll be around $400,000.
Is left.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay.
And do we expect another decorative fencing to be done at another bridge somewhere else? Or what's the plan for the rest of them?
There has been discussion. It started off early part of the program, the Druid Hills neighborhood, the Ponce de Leon Bridge. There were some investigations done on working with the railroad and GDOT to upgrade the historic facade.
Gotcha. Okay.
But that's just sort of been in early discussions. Beyond these three bridges on 285, there's been nothing identified.
Okay. All right. I'll be happy to make a motion if that's in order.
I will be happy to receive it.
All right. Yes. I'll move to approve item 1697.
I will second that motion, and all those in favor of approval of 1697, show of hands and words. Aye. Okay. Let the record reflect that we have approved 1697. The next item that I'm showing in queue is item 1559, and it is a low bid for valve boxes and risers for use by the Department of Watershed Management. Consists of the purchase of valve boxes and risers recommended to the four lowest responsive and responsible bidders. And let me go to my notes on 1559. This is a three-year contract. And the total is to be paid over the three-year period. And the valve, as a point of reference, the valve boxes and risers are used when installing water meters and valves. Anyone care to say any more about this particular item, not to exceed $1,059,000?
Thank you, Commissioner. This, as you said, this is a three-year contract, and the spend will be estimated to be around $353,000 per year. This is just a standard low bid ask.
Any questions from fellow commissioners or any of our visiting commissioners? Okay, seeing none, Commissioner Terry, is there a motion from the floor?
Yes, I will move to recommend approval of item 1559.
I will second the motion for approval. All those in favor, show of hands and words.
Aye. Aye.
Next item that I show in queue is item number 1665, and this is a change order. Pond maintenance services for use by Public Works, Roads and Drainage, and the Department of Recreation, Parks and Cultural Affairs. Contract consists of cutting, cleaning, spraying, and repair and maintenance of stormwater retention and detention ponds. Awarded to Williams Icon Homes and Properties, ASAP Landscape Management Group, and Executive Realty Solutions, Inc., not to exceed $760,000. This is an important item because more and more we're getting calls about stormwater retention and detention ponds. And I understand that we've not per se had a dedicated company to assist in the maintenance of those. This increased the contract amount and extends the amount from August, the time from August to December. And this will allow us to have a new contract put in place for bidding. And also on this particular ask, Parks and Recreation Cultural Affairs added a small amount to the existing contract. Is there anything else that needs to be said concerning this particular contract, 1665?
Yeah, I'll go ahead and just elaborate just a little bit on that, that the as you said, the existing contract expires in August. This change order extends it to the end of the calendar year, which also coincides a little bit more clearly with growing seasons, such that we can proceed with a new contract new acquisition of contract to cover an entire growing season rather than having it chop off in the middle. If we, you know, let this thing expire right now, we'd still have part of August and September in all likelihood. Where we would be looking for a new contract. This just makes it a lot easier for us to continue to maintain as much as we can. You know, we've got well over 1,000 ponds, retention facilities in the county. You know, it's very important that we try to, step up this program and continue to do a lot of catch up, because we've got some of these that have really not been touched for quite some time.
Absolutely.
I have a question.
Yes, go right ahead, Commissioner Terry.
I definitely appreciate the need to, you know, basically cut back some really overgrown detention ponds, because we get emails about them, and you know, you have kind of like the one resident, Director Lemke, who says, there's rats and rodents and all manner of creatures living in their things, and then you have the other resident that's like, there's creatures living in there. Why are you destroying their habitat? I was out months ago, and I was meeting with someone over near Katy Kerr Drive, right outside Decatur city limits. And they were mad at us because it was a little condo complex. And I guess we just came in, and I don't know if we did it or our contractor did it, but we just sort of basically mowed the entire little pond for their subdivision. And it literally was just like down, you know, it was just like literally like cut down to the bare, you know, dirt. And, you know, I assume that, you know, in a year it'll grow back up and then we'll come back out, or maybe in a matter of years, depending on the list, that we'll just kind of keep cutting it back. And so I wonder if maybe this is more for Mr. Williams as well, CEO Williams, but, you know, when we talk about long-term maintenance of these detention ponds, is it more efficient to just consistently spray and go in with a bush hog? Or is there a potential paradigm that would allow us to, in essence, you know, scrub a lot of the invasive species? So treat it more, instead of a cut, as more of a scrub of the land, and plant plants back that, you know, in essence will be the good kind of plants And so the idea is that we don't need to cut them back because they're the beneficial, you know, kind of bioswale rain garden type of plant. And that maybe we wouldn't need to go back and just continue to kind of manage the growth because it's just privet and kudzu. And it's a type of invasive that no matter how many times you come in through with the bush hog, it'll just keep coming back. Sure. And I'm just wondering if there's a way that in a future contract we can fold in a remediation. Right. I don't know. I think the word is like bioremediation or something. Right. With the goal of saying we don't have to come back and mow it every year.
Sure.
Because we don't have enough. Yeah. Power.
Let's take a look at that, because what you're describing, as opposed to, you're right, that our traditional approach is to bush hog or shred. And just take it down to a certain level, and then it's going to come up over some period of time. What you're proposing is to not only bush hog, but then come in and actually clear down to the soil and then plant certain types of plant material that would either not grow as fast so as to compromise the detention pond, or would be more absorbent or something like that. I don't know that we've ever looked at it from that perspective, Commissioner, so I'm not prepared to answer that. But we can take a look to see what are people doing in that regard. And if there's something that we could do that, yes, it would cost more initially, but maybe over 1, 2, or 3 years, it would save money, provided we can keep the invasives out once you do that. You know, once you put in native plant material or those that would be sustainable, you still have to assure that the kudzu and other things don't go back and overtake it. So,
yeah. And I know, Director Lemke, you've said that you've worked in other jurisdictions with bioswales and rain gardens. And so, I mean, maybe the approach is just if we could just, maybe it's the next contract. I mean, so this contract ends, we're extending this current one, and are we doing a new RFP?
Yeah, I believe we'd end up doing a new RFP.
Okay. So I would just suggest if we could, you know, throw in a, you know, like, let's just do a couple pilots. Right. And just ask.
I think there's a number of opportunities that are, you know, the county has in front of it right now. You know, we're playing catch up with so many of these that, you know, some of these ponds literally have not been touched for 10 years.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I don't want to delay. I don't want to delay the ones that are just completely, you know, chaotic.
But I think you're right. I think there are opportunities that we can certainly examine as we move forward.
Okay. Now, so part of this contract is addressing detention ponds in parks. Is that right?
Detention pond. Absolutely. Yes. Okay. All over. And let me say that whatever the pilot is that needs to be brought to us and clearly expressed, if that is the route we're going to go, because we are very far behind on the work that is currently associated with the retention and the detention ponds. So I'm not opposed, but I would want to clearly see it and understand what the new plan or course of action would look like for this pilot, so that we can flesh it out under the circumstances, just to ensure that it's well thought out. So if it's implemented, it's implemented under the best possible conditions, because we are dealing with a lot of issues associated with the lack of maintenance of our retention and detention ponds.
Yeah, I totally agree, Madam Chair. And maybe like a very specific suggestion would be, because, you know, like these landscape companies, you know, they'll do the mow and blow if you ask them to. But if you say, hey, could you do a bioswale, you know, here, here, and here, and just say that's part of the contract, I mean, they'll find a way to do it, right? And they're, I mean, this landscapers, they know about it, but no one ever asks them to do it. And so, you know, it just never ends up being done. But, you know, I would suggest we ask Director Ellis, is there one detention pond that if we did sort of, you know, cut it in the normal course of things, and if we did a little scrub, could we do a little bio retention at one of the parks, you know, and then it becomes a learning opportunity or something with a little sign. But just, you know, I don't know, maybe there, we could just pick one or two, maybe one's a park, one's a residential one, maybe one's more of a public detention pond. I don't know.
Understood.
One thing I want to say about this is that a lot of times it depends on the actual retention detention area, because if silt buildup is your biggest issue, then you're going to dig out no matter what you plant there, because you're going to need to really take that base down. So I think it just depends on the location and the water buildup in that particular spot.
Absolutely. All right. So I'll motion to approve item 1665.
I will second, and all those in favor of approval, show of hands and words. Aye.
Aye.
Let the record reflect we have approved item 1665. The next item that I show is item 1696, and this is a renewal for rock crushing. And this is an annual contract, first renewal option of two, for crushing rock, granite, stone, and hauling materials to and from the Seminole Road landfill in the amount of $150,000. This one is pretty self-explanatory, and it seems that this rock crushing contract comes back every month, it appears. You will see too, there is a slight price increase, but materials are used for roads and grading. With that being said, is there anything that anyone wishes to add as it relates to this contract? There's been no issue with the contract, so this would just be a standard renewal under the options of the contract.
I don't really think I've got a whole lot to add to what you just summarized. Certainly it's something that we use all the time to maintain the roadways, you know, within the Seminole County landfill. And as you may have heard this morning with the committee as a whole, that, you know, we have a lot of materials that come into that landfill that we reuse. And, you know, if we have a lot of this material come in, we can certainly crush it and then use it as gravel for the roadways.
Understood. Any questions from committee members or any of those who are joining us? And if not, I would entertain a motion on the floor for the renewal of the contract.
I move to approve item 1696.
And I will second. All those in favor, show of hands and words. Aye.
Aye.
Let the record reflect we have approved the renewal of the rock crushing contract 1696. The next item that we have in queue is item 1703. And this is a change order number 4 for inspection of sanitary sewer stream crossings for use by the Department of Watershed Management for inspections and assessments of sewer stream crossings. In the amount not to exceed $350,000. And what we have here is an increase of $350,000 and a time extension through December 31st. There is an active ITB invitation to bid that is out, but until we can make the award, we need to keep this contract in place so that we can continue the much needed sanitary sewer stream crossing work, assessments and inspections. Anyone care to add any more to 1703?
Thank you. That is correct. This is a method to allow continuity until we can have awarded the new ITB that's currently in progress. We're trying to keep our work on going forward without any interruptions.
Understood. That being said, this is an extension until which time we can, of course, get the ITB complete, but it allows us to continue the assessments in the meantime. So Commissioner Terry, any questions from you or any concerns after viewing the packet and this particular item? If not, I would accept a motion.
No, I think we answered everything. And so the contract is extending until when again? The end of the year?
December 31st.
December 31st. Okay. Gotcha. Okay, there it is. All right, thank you. Okay. Yes, I will. Yes, motion. I move to approve item 1703.
I will second. All those in favor, show of hands and words. Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Let the record reflect we have approved 1703. And the last item of the day is 1724, and it is an extension in term only. It is a change order for storm drainage infrastructure system construction for public works stormwater projects for use by public works, roads and drainage, and the Department of Recreation, Parks and Cultural Affairs, contract for providing storm drainage construction services. And on 1724, let me go to my notes. This is a general contractor that we use. The contract was to expire at the end of the month, end of June, but this will allow us to extend the contract through June 30th of 2023. So we're extending for 1 year. There is an ITB out, but it has not been awarded at the moment. And that pretty much, that's the extent of that. Anyone have anything else to say on 1724?
No, this is the main contract that we use for repair work for any of the deficiencies that crop up in the storm sewer system. This is the thing that we use if we have sinkholes, if we have pipe collapses. These are critical contracts for the department, which is why we're asking for the extension in term so that this contract does not expire and get us caught without an ability to address these items.
Understood. Commissioner Terry?
And so is this the same contract that will fix the, or that can has the ability to fix the little culvert boxes over the storm drains?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, because I definitely have been sending you a few resident complaints of, loose,
Yeah, I mean,
that's covered in this contract, right?
It can be covered under this contract. Typically, we use this for the more extensive types of projects, the work that are, the pipe replacements and whatnot. We are looking at a separate program for reconstruction and cleaning of catch basins and inlets. I guess the short answer is yes, we can use this contract for that purpose.
Okay. Yeah, just because I know there was like a few that neighbors had sent where I guess a truck had knocked one off or one is just completely open. So, I would just ask that if we could, if there's any open catch basins where there's just no lid on it, that those are definitely a priority because we don't want.
Yeah, and a lot of those we handle in-house as well. So,
yeah. I mean, after I saw that movie, It, Director Lemke, I just, we got to watch out for those storm basins. avoid them at all costs. Okay. All right. That's all the questions I had. Thank you.
Understood. That being said, is there a motion from the floor?
Motion to approve item 1724.
I will second. All those in favor, show of hands and words. Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Well, I think that brings us to the end of the program. We were able successfully, after having pretty extensive presentations today, to make it through the roster. So I'd like to say thank you to Commissioner Terry for being present so that we had the capacity to get through the agenda today. And for all of you who join us and for those who have the meeting before the meeting to ensure that the meeting goes well and my questions are answered to help move us along progressively, I'd like to thank you. And if there is no further business to come before Public Works and Infrastructure today, I would accept a motion.
I'll move to adjourn the meeting.
And I will second. All those in favor, show of hands and words.
Aye.
Aye. Enjoy your evening. Afternoon.